next lecture in computer architecture, which deals with one of the basic fundamentals, how the computer is built up. These are the topics that we shall be covering here. We shall talk about some of the system buses, instruction codes, computer registers, computer instructions, timing and control, instruction cycle, memory reference instructions, input-output interrupt, complete computer description, design of a basic computer, design of an accumulator logic. So these are the basic things that we shall be covering here in this particular lecture, and not all will be covered in one lecture because it is quite lengthy, and we shall be covering in at least in two lectures, two video lectures. And though I have already started this thing earlier also, I'm just going to repeat few things, few lines, so that it becomes clear, because it's after a gap when we are covering the things. It is mandatory to pick up the, from the old threads. So here we have a system bus. The diagram is a basic diagram of a computer, which shows the control unit, data path, central processing unit. It is the central processing unit which encompasses one data path, one control unit, and there is a system bus which is in common with the input-output system and the memory. And they are able to exchange the data with the help of the system bus here. And the input and the output, these are the lines. This is the structure of a basic computer, it has been shown. And now let us see. A major computer system components, processor, main memory, input-output modules need to be interconnected in order to exchange data and control signals. Bus is a communication pathway connecting two or more devices. Bus that connects major computer components, processor, memory, input, output is called a system bus. As shown in the last diagram, we have already seen that the system bus is connecting the input, output, memory, and the CPU, central processing unit. It is making a some sort of bridge between the two kinds of devices, and the data is being exchanged through the system bus, which helps in transference of information from one end to the other on a time cycle. It is not that every component will start sending the data directly onto the bus, and it is the time duration which will be allocated to each of the device, and then they will be sending the data onto the system bus, and corresponding exchange of information can take place in between the two kinds of devices here. Next thing that we had discussed in the last class, I think it was the CPU, memory. This is one of the methods of showing how the various kinds of devices can be attached. These are the control lines, address lines and data lines here, and CPU, memory and input output devices which have been shown to be part of the attachments system bus. Now, multiple bus hierarchies. In general, the more devices attached to the bus, the greater the bus length, and hence greater the propagation delay. The bus may become bottleneck as aggregate data transfer demand approaches to the capacity of the bus. If the data on the channel or on the system bus exceeds a particular limit, then this clogging or bottlenecks can take place in the system bus, so it becomes quite unmanageable here, and new methods have been to be evolved for synchronization purpose. So synchronized buses or synchronous buses include a clock between the control lines that is controlled by the clock parts oscillator, usually between 5 to 133 megahertz. There is a crystal clock oscillator. And all the transfer on the system bus has a fixed protocol related to the clock signal, and it is developed along the integer number of cycles called bus cycles. Advantages of synchronous bus are high speed of a transfer, the very simple implied logic. The disadvantage comes from transfer that can be shorter than the time corresponding to the integer number of bus cycles. So, advantages of synchronous bus are high speed transfer. If we have a synchronization amongst the components, then each and every component will be able to transfer according to the time slot allocated. And the disadvantage is that the transfer can be shortened because every component will be allocated only a small duration. And it is possible that it may not be able to transfer the complete set of data, and it will have to wait for its next turn when it comes up. So this delay has to be there, the delay will be during the larger transfer of data, and it can be observed on the computer systems very clearly. The disadvantage that we have written in the last sentence is very important here. The disadvantage comes from transfer that can be shorter than the time corresponding to the integer number of bus cycles here. So, next point, let us see. Introduction here continues. Every different processor type has its own design, different registers, buses, micro operations, machine instructions. Now, we talk about the processors. Each and every processor that Intel has made has its own instruction set. So, if we talk about, say, Intel 4004 to 8085, there is a large variation in the integer in the instruction set that has been included or incorporated. And the present day scenario is that Intel is having i3, i5, and i7, and all these architectures will have drastically different set of instruction sets, which though they carry the previous instructions as well, but almost the number of registers and the registers that are included in the newest the processors is quite large in number, and therefore it becomes quite complex to study. Modern processors are very complex devices. That is the reason why they have written that modern processors are very complex devices. The reason is it has millions of transistors with the help of which the flip-flops or resistors are being made. It contains many resistors, many units, because many resistors will be there. There is need for a separate circuitry to handle those resistors. Then multiple arithmetic units, or for both integer and the floating point calculations, is required here. The reason is, if you want to perform large number of calculations with the help of a computer, there may be a chance that the processor may be having additional devices attached to it. For those are called as peripheral devices, or the slave devices, which are part of the main processor, and they will be helping in the calculation process. For example, the floating point calculations or the integer point calculations can be done. So these are this makes the things more cumbersome in handling the information as far as it is concerned. The ability to pipeline several consecutive instructions to speed execution is also it is a problem here. So, next, understand how processors work. We'll start with the simplified processor model, similar to the real processors were like 25 years ago. Maurice Mano, now the book which we are utilizing, has given a processor, and that processor we shall be studying here in for this whole semester, and we shall be implementing it in the lab as well, because the program is also available with us, and we will see how it is working. We will use this to introduce processor organizations and the relationship to the RTL model to the higher level computer process. So we'll see how the computer will interact and how the instructions like move, add, add, and all those micro machine level instructions can be incorporated into the processor, and how the programming can be done for our processor. Okay, so we shall be knowing about these things in the later classes here. So let us start with the basics of a computer here. Basic computer has two components, a processor and a memory. This diagram shows a CPU and a RAM. The size of the RAM is 4096 bytes. It is shown 4096 words here. And 4096, for addressing those 4096, you require 2^12, means 12 bits of data is required to address here. It's like one word of memory. And each word will contain 16 bits of information, as shown here, 0 to 15, the 16 bits of information. So what we can depict it as, is suppose this is a kind of an Elmira. In this kind of Elmira, there are 4096 slots, and each slot can contain 16 bits of information here. So it is like 4096 4K memory, in which the address to address each slot, we require 12 bits of address information is required here. So in this particular, we can write about this kind of memory can also be written as 404K into 16.
because it's a 16-bit word, it is storing here. So we can write it as 4096 into 16 or 404k into 16 kind of memory. So this is because it can store 16 bits of information per slot. And next.
Program is a sequence of machine instructions that we have already discussed. Program means the way of doing a particular task. So it is step-by-step information, so it is called as a sequence of instructions given to the machine. And machine instruction, a group of bits that tell the computer to perform a specific operation, a sequence of micro operations. The instruction of a program along with the needed data are stored in memory. The CPU reads the next instruction from the memory. It is placed in the instruction register, the control circuitry in a control unit that translates the instruction into the sequence of micro operations necessary to implement it. Now in this particular thing you will see that a sequence of micro instructions is called a program, and a machine instruction, a group of bits that tell the computer to perform a specific operation. Now what kind of operation that can be performed? It is the addition, subtraction or multiplication or division kind of operation that can be performed with the help of the processor. The instruction of a program along with the needed data are stored in the memory. Now this line is based upon stored program concept. The instructions of a program along with the needed data are stored in the memory. So it is the stored program concept which has been carried over since ages. The CPU reads the next instruction from the memory. It is placed in an instruction register IR and control circuitry in the control unit then translates the instruction into the sequence of micro operations necessary to implement. So the instructions are stored in the instruction register. It is a 16-bit register, and this instruction register has 12 bits of address, 3 bits of opcode and 1 I bit. So what happens, it can address 2 raised to power 12 addresses, and there will be 8 opcodes that can be generated because of the 3 bits. 8 codes can be generated, and I bit which indicates whether the instruction is a direct I or indirect I. So I value is also included into it, and if I value is 0 it is direct, and if I value is 1 it is an indirect type of instruction. So let us see the next slide, in which we are discussing little bit about the instruction format. A computer instruction is often divided into two parts. An opcode or the operation code that specifies the operation for that instruction. Now this opcode or the operation code, it represents the kind of operation that is to be performed. Operation code. Now what kind of operation code can be performed here? In this way, this is addition, subtraction, multiplication, all these comes under this operation code, and it specifies the operation to be performed. Opcode and operand. There are two terms. Operands and opcodes. So you have to remember these two terms, 1 and 2. Opcodes, of course, these are the operations. Now what are the operations? Plus, minus, and division, multiplication and all these operands. So on what data the operations are being performed, they are the operands. On which the operations are being performed. Now next, the basic computer, since the memory contains 4096 2 raised to power 12 words, we need 12 bits to specify. Now we have already written that the instruction is stored inside the instruction register, and the instruction is register is 16 bits, 0 to 11, 12, 13 and 14 and then 15 bits. This is for I and this is for your opcode, and this is of course for the address. These are the 12 bits, and which will give us the value of the address to be generated, and 3 bits of the opcode. Okay. Then let us see this thing. This is what we have already written here, and we have already, I think, slightly discussed about it at length also in the earlier class. So we'll continue from this one next time. Let us see. And then we had to discuss this at length. What are the direct instructions and what are the direct addressing and the indirect addressing modes? We had discussed how the direct addressing can be done and what do you mean by indirect addressing. Here this shows, this particular shows the indirect addressing, and this shows the direct addressing schema. So next thing that we will be, this thing has already been, and repeating this thing because this is mostly required in the further slides, so I'm just repeating those things. So from here the concept of a direct instruction, because I is 0 here, indirect instruction the I is 1 here, and here 300 represents another address, and 300 we contain another address 1350 from which the operand is to be fetched from. So here inside the accumulator, which is a processor, main processor register, main process register. Okay, so this is very important here, accumulator, main processor register, and in which the calculations take place, and we have this has already been discussed. And now let us see what are the things that we have today. Okay, now from today, today's class basically begins from this, so I have just repeated the things just for your information sake, because this is the most essential part which needs repetition again and again. Let us see. A processor has many register instructions, addresses, data, etc. A processor has register program counter that holds the memory address of the next instruction to be. Now, what is the use of this program counter? Now, we have already discussed that there is a register called PC or the program counter. This program counter helps in identifying or storing the address of the next instruction to be fetched. Stores the address of the next instruction to be fetched from in a program. Now, this 12 bits of memory, 4096 location, PC is only 12 bits. Okay, since it contains only the address, so it doesn't require to be 16 bits. That is the main important thing that you have to note down. PC is a 12 bit register. It is not a 16 bit register. The reason is, it is just storing the address of the next instruction to be fetched from. And we already know that we are using a basic computer. And in a basic computer, we have 12 bits are for the address part. So therefore, this program counter is only of 12 bits and not of 16 bits. That's the important point. Next, it is the address register. It's a 12 bit basic computer, and then we have DR is the data register. In a direct or indirect addressing, the processor needs to keep a track of what locations in memory it is addressing. The address register is used for this. The AR is a 12 bit register in the basic computer, and when an operand is found using either direct or indirect addressing, it is placed in the data register. What is the need for this particular data register? The need for this particular data register is to get the values of operands. Why do we require operands? Because we want to perform operations. What are the operations or the opcodes? These opcodes are already part of the instruction register. It is contained in the instruction register, and which can be decoded with the help of decoder. So the data register contains operands. The basic computer has a single general purpose accumulator. So it is the most important single general purpose register, which is called as accumulator. The significance of the general purpose register is that it can be referred to an instruction load AC with the contents of a specific memory location, store the contents of AC, for example LDA, STA. These are some of the kinds of instructions that you will come to know: store accumulator and load accumulator, and specified memory locations. From the specified memory locations, say for example, if we give the address, so LDA 4050, STA, sorry, comma. So these are the instructions. It means now this makes the meaning of this one clear. Load AC with the contents of a specific memory location. Now what happens if 4050 is a some sort of an address and it contains some data that will be loaded inside the accumulator here. Next is the storing the contents of accumulator onto a specific location, say here. So this is slightly the use of the accumulator register, which is the main processing register. The basic computer uses a very simple model of input-output operations. The input devices are considered to send, because we have already discussed that the input devices, input and output devices, they are of 8 bit each. So 8 bit of transfer of information will take place between the input and output devices in a BSI computer. Please note, it is in a BSI computer, not everywhere. So in a BSI computer, input register and output register, they have the capacity of 8 bits, and input devices are considered to send 8 bits of character data to the processor here. And next, the processor can send 8 bits of character data onto the output devices. The input register INPR holds 8 bit character generated from the input device. Output register OUTR holds 8 bit character sent to an output device. So it is most common here. That is what we have written, OUTR and INPR, and both of them have the 8 bit capacity. So till now, let us revise again. We have discussed the address register, accumulator register, then we have discussed about the concept of direct addressing and indirect addressing. So let us go slightly ahead and see the diagram for the BSI computer, which we have already seen also in our theory class, in the class. Here is the program counter, it is of 12 bits. Address register is of also 12 bits. You can see that here the OUTR and INPR registers, they are of 8 bits. Instruction register is of 16 bits, temporary register is also of 16 bits, accumulator, which is the main processor register, it is also of 16 bits, DR is the data register, which has the capacity to store 16 bits of information, and memory here, it is written as 4096 into 16, it can hold 4096 into 16 kinds, 16 data values. Now it is already written here, you can see that the DR, AR, AC, IR, PC, TR, INUR, OUBR, and the values it can hold. It is the 8 bit register. This is the register capacity. So here 16 bit, 12 bits, 16 bits, 12, 16, 12, 16, 8, and 8. Both OUBR and INPR, they are 8 bits. Temporary register is 16 bits. Program counter, which stores the address of the next instruction to be fetched from, is 12 bits. Instruction register is 16 bits. And the main processor register is 16 bits. Address register is also 12 bits. And data register is of 16 bits in a basic computer. Kindly note, we are talking about only a basic computer. So let us go ahead with this. Now next thing, the registers of the BSI computer are connected using a bus. This gives the savings in the circuitry over complete connections between the registers. Now let us see, this is the kind of diagram here. This shows that this is the system bus, which is connected with the help of the signals. Select signals are there, S0, S1 and S2. And we have to, in order to select the bus, there will be a variation of the information on the lines S2, S1 and S0, 00, 0, 00, 1, so on, 1, 1 and 1. Okay, so here you can go up to this one, and these values will be used for selecting the different components here in the circuit. And here this shows that memory unit is selected to 7, and AR register is 1, and PC is 2, BR is 3, AC 4, and IR is 5, TR is 6, OUBR, and this one, what is it called, the INBR. See, you can see that INBR is connected to a ALU, and the accumulator is connected back here, and load INR, CNR, these are the three things here. So we have already covered many of the things here in detail. So you can see this particular table, which says that when it is 000, nothing is selected. When it is 1, AR. When it is 2, it is PC. And when it is 3, it is DR register. When it is 4, it is the accumulator register. When it is 5, it is the instruction register which is being selected here. When it is 6, now you can see that it is temporary register, and 111, it is the memory that is 7. It was shown that it was 7 here. And corresponding, the decimal values were written 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. I remember the resistors will have its load signal activated. So here we can see that when the select line is 111, we will be able to select only specific resistor. So we can see here it is 111, then memory is selected, and it is 110, it is PR, and it is 101, it is the IR instruction register. The 12-bit resistor IR and PC have zeros loaded into the bus in the higher order 4-bit positions. Now what happens here, the 12-bit resistors AR and PC, because they are 12 bits of resistors, have 0 loaded onto the bus in the higher order 4-bit positions. Okay? When the 8-bit resistor OUBR is loaded into the bus, the data comes from the lower order 8 bits on the bus. So you can see that here we are using the lower 8 bits. Here AR and BC have the higher values. The values that are put are zeros, because they are already 12 bits and we need 4 more, which will make them as a 16 bit resistor. We require only the 12 bits, and the pending remaining 4 bits are put or embedded with the embossed with the 0 value. Now next thing that we have already started, this is the kind of instructions that are there. There are basically 3 kinds of instructions that we have to note down: 1, 2 and 3. Now these are the memory reference instructions. Let us see how can we use a memory reference instruction here. This is the format for 16-bit data. These are the addresses: 12 bits of address, 3 bits of opcode, 12, 13 and 14. 15 is the I bit. I value will be 0 or 1 in this case. Will be 0 or 1 in this case. And here it is 0, here it is 1 here. Now what is the difference between this kind of instruction and this kind of instruction? Let us see. The opcode value will be 111 and I value will be 0. The opcode value will be 111 and I value will be 1 here. Here in this case, the opcode value will range from 000 to 110. It will go up to 6 and it will not go beyond that. So the major difference between a basic memory reference instruction register reference and input output reference instruction is the value of opcode and I value.
Later on we will have to identify what kind of instructions are they, whether they are memory reference instructions or they are register reference instruction or input output reference instruction. We have to note down this because it is the most important part.
This register reference instruction, it is I value is 0 here. Now input output reference instruction, I value is 1 here. And here in the case of memory reference instruction, you will find that it is either 0 or 1. So opcode 12, 13 and 14 bit will indicate here. The next diagram that we will be attempting, but the most important thing here is you have to remember that it is 000 and 110. You cannot go up to 111. The reason is it has been utilized for other kinds of instructions. So on observing this memory reference instruction, you will find that there are three opcodes. And if we use only 3 opcodes, then we will be able to generate only 8 instructions.
But is it so? But we are using only 6, up to 6, that means 7
instructions. So 0, either I value is 0, you can see the next diagram, let us see, it is going to make the things more clear. The I value can be 0, I value can be 1, and I is the opcode and address. So you can see here, it goes when I is 0, it is 0 triple X and 6 triple X, I is 1, 8 double X and E double X. Now how do we get this? What is this 0? This 0 stands for the opcode 0. Okay? And rest these X, these are the hexagonal values and they are 4 bits each. So there are 12 bits because we know that address is of 12 bits and they have been represented with the help of these hexagonal values. This is 4 bits, 4 bits, 4 bits, which makes it 12 bits, and this is represented as 0, X and X. So here this is the instruction when memory reference instruction when it is of the type direct. And in the case of indirect, we will have 1 here and 1x, and we will go up to 6, and the value will be because we will be using 100, and it will be x and x and x. So here this 100 is 8. Because 7 has not to be utilized, so only up to 6, and then 7 will not utilize, and then again let us start with 8. So it makes this is 00, and when this becomes 1, it becomes 8, and this X and X and X. Okay, so this makes hexagonal, it makes the code hex code. Okay, now. In the case of register reference instruction, you will find that this value is 7 and this is some value X and X and X. Okay? So we can mark it as 7800, 7001, and here in this case it is 111, so it all becomes F. F, X and X and X and so on. So F800, we are using F800 and F040. So let us see the instructions have available here, and the contents of the memory to accumulator, add the memory word to AC, LDA, load accumulator, store the contents of accumulator to the memory, burn means branch unconditionally. So you can see here I0, the value will be different, when BSA branch and save return address, this will come to know later on when how this is implemented. ISZ, increment and skip if 0, and these are the instructions which are in the case of say register reference, these are input output reference, these are the memory reference instructions. So we will start the process here now, instruction set completeness. So how do we say a particular machine language is complete in nature? So if any language that is being used in a computer system must have the following functionality available with it. It must be having functional instructions, It must have the transfer instructions, it must have the control instructions, it must have the input output instructions. 1, 2, 3 and 4. These are the four components which make the language, machine language, particularly the kind of machine language that is being used in the computers, complete. It must have a functional instruction set, which means it must provide with arithmetic logic instructions, it must be providing with add, complement, increment, circle right, circle left, and CLA and so on. And in this case, transfer instructions, data transfer between the main memory and the processor. We have already started with load accumulator and store accumulator contents. Load accumulator means loading the memory and loading the accumulator from some memory area. And store accumulator means storing the contents of the accumulator onto a particular memory location. So next is the control instructions, which is like 1, BSA and ISZ. These instructions make or provide make the language complete set. Input output instructions must also be available. Input and output instructions is INP and OUT. So this makes the whole process complete in SR. So these are the four components which are very essential to make the language a complete language. So let us see the control unit. The control unit is a processor that translates the machine instructions to the control signals and microoperations that implement them. Control units are implemented in one of the two ways. One is hardwire control, one is the microprogram control. So how do we create a control unit? There are two basic methods. One is with the help of pure hardware. And another one, it is a combination of software and hardware, and which is called as microprogram control. A control memory on the processor contains microprograms that activate the necessary control signals. Now, in this particular case, you will find that there is a control memory which contains the on the processor and contains microprograms that activate the necessary control signals. And in this case, is sequential and combination. It is made up of hardware control. Is purely made up of hardware. There is a problem or disadvantage of hardware is that if we want to make a certain change in the hardware structure, then whole of the hardware is to be replaced with a new one. So there is a problem here. But in the case of microprogram control, we just need to change the program and restore it back at the CMOS, and then we can start working with that. That is the biggest advantage of using a microprogram control environment and over the hardwired control systems. So you can see this diagram here. You will find that this is the status information, and this is some sort of hardware, and there is a state register here, which are generating control signals, and then is purely a hardware. Now microprograms, we already discussed that it is a memory and which will contain the programs which will generate the control instructions, control signals. Now let us see the most important diagram, timing and control unit, which is the most essential part here. And here the diagram shows the instruction register, which is a 12-bit register, and these are 12, 13 and 14, which is for the opcode, and the I value, which is the 15-bit register, and this value will be sent to a flip-flop. This is a single value, so it is called as flip-flop. Okay. So this is flip flop, and these 3 bits are passed on to a 3:8 decoder, and which is going to generate D0 to D7 control signals. And here this is a 4 bit sequence counter, which is going to generate the 16 timing signals from P0 to P15, and which will be passed through 4:16 decoder. And you can see that it is also having increment or clear options are also available here. So a counter will count and produce pulses, and which you will be able to see that it is able to generate the timing and control unit for the PC computer here. Now in this particular diagram, you will observe that the D0 to D7 signals are being passed out to a combinational logic circuit, and which generates the control signals here. And along with it, 16 timing signals T0 to T15 are also passed, And according to the timing diagram, then only this will be generated. For example, let us take one example here. D3, D4. It suggests that generate 4-bit sequence counter and is 4:16 decoder. The sequence counter can be incremented here. Example T0, T1, T2, T3, T4. Again, so if we say D3, D4, at time T4, D3 will become active and the sequence counter is cleared to 0. So, how is this shown with the help of timing diagram? This is the timing diagram. Okay, now in this particular timing diagram, you will be able to find that there is a clock here shown T0, T1, T2, T3, T4, again T0. So let us see how this is working here. T0, again it goes on, and till T4, again then it will be reset again. Okay, so D3, T0, you will find that D3 will become during the fourth timing cycle here, it is high and then it goes on. Then clear signal is also there. After this was clear, when it is high, this whole becomes 0 because it is not required. In this case, it is 0. Okay. Sequence counter. Okay. Then. So this shows the D3, D4 timing signal being generated. So in a basic computer, a machine instruction is executed in the following cycles. These are the cycles. Number 1, fetch the instruction from the memory. Number 2, decode the instruction and then read the effective address of the memory. And if the instruction has indirect address, then you have to read that address. Then number 4, you have to execute the instruction. So after the instruction is executed, the cycle starts again at step 1 for the next instruction. Note, every different processor has its own different instruction. So this we will be dealing in the next class, and we shall be finishing this completely in the next class.